first I'd like to thank the c&en for giving me this honor. And since I'm the last one in the session, I thought I could go over time a little bit and try hard to make it after the session as Laura has always wanted. So today I'm going to talk about some of the work that we have done in the past years on engineering living systems and a little bit of my background. So I did my undergraduate in biomedical engineering in Southeast University in China. And since then, I have not changed my major. And I came to the States for my master at WashU in 2008, exactly 10 years ago, after which I actually moved with my PhD advisor, Professor Yolan Xia, to Georgia Tech, again in the Department of Biomedical Engineering, jointly with Emory University. And about 5 years ago, I arrived at Boston to do my postdoc, as Lauren just mentioned, under supervision of Professor Ali Kadamseni, and which is where I stayed as faculty, which is in the Division of Engineering Medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital, which is part of Harvard Med School, and basically essentially a biomedical engineering division in hospital. So so today I'm going to give you, like briefly talk about my trajectory in the past 10 years in engineering functional human tissues and tissue models using a combination of technologies and strategies ranging from biomaterials and chemistry of materials to biofabrication and biomedical devices and all the way to bioanalysis. So the story starts from a lack or a severe lack of donor organs for transplantation. And we know that many people die from the lack of donor organs, not even mentioning the high costs associated with the processes. So to this end, tissue engineering, the concept of tissue engineering was raised about 3 decades ago, which essentially allowed us to generate functional human tissues outside human body, which we can use to transplant back into the human system for regeneration purpose. And tissue engineering is essentially a multidisciplinary technology which combines different components for generating functional tissues and organs that we can eventually use for transplantation. And one of the most important components is the scaffolds, right? So basically, it's the structural material that gives you the ability to host the cells in 3 dimensions and allowing them to function. And among the different scaffold systems, pore scaffolds is especially important because they have interconnected pores that allow cells to communicate and also allow the diffusion of nutrients and the bioactive molecules. However, one of the issues with conventional fabrication strategies for the pore scaffolds lies in the inability to reproduce the pore structures, right? So if you look at scaffolds fabricated using across different batches, they have all different structures, right? So making it very difficult to engineer tissues that are having uniform qualities. So this basically prompted my research in my graduate school, which was to generate these kind of inversible scaffolds using a specialized strategy, giving us the chance to generate fabricate scaffolds of uniform, with uniform pores. And to do this, we basically use the microfluidic device to produce uniform microparticles, which we can use to pack together to form the lattice. Right? So once you have the lattice, you can infiltrate the secondary polymer material into the space between the microspheres. And by removing the microspheres, eventually you can form this inverse opal scaffolds with very uniform pore sizes. Right? So, as I mentioned, then you can start to use this inversible scaffolds with very controllable properties for engineering functional tissues that are uniform across the different properties. And by controlling, for example, the microspheres or the sizes of microspheres that we make for templating purpose, we can make scaffolds of different pore sizes, but in each scaffold, the pore size is actually very uniform. Right? We can control also the, for example, leaning temperature of this little lattice and make sure that we can get scaffolds having different window sizes, which are basic in the interconnecting interconnecting cavities between the different pores. And we can also modulate the chemistry or the material properties to be able to generate the surface sizes, like scaffolds with different surface sizes, to also modulate tissue behaviors. So now we can start to engineer the different tissue types for regeneration purpose, or to study the biological behaviors of cells and tissues within these kind of scaffolds, right? So these range from, for example, vascularization, cell migration, cell body production in scaffolds, and also generating patches that we can use for wound healing purposes directly on the patients. And take vascularization as an example, right? So these pore sizes, the scaffolds with different pore sizes allows us to basically modulate how the vasculature or the host tissue is responding to the scaffolds. Right? For example, the surface pore size actually determines how the infiltration efficiency of the vessels from the outside of the scaffolds into the scaffolds. And then the pore size that I mentioned actually determines the time of progression of the vessels, infiltrating vessels between before they actually encounter the barrier. And lastly, the window size, which is the size of the interconnection between different pores, actually determines the ease of penetration of the vessels into the secondary structures or interior structure of the scaffolds. And eventually, by this way, we can control how the tissue is responding to the scaffolds that we implant into the human system. And histology does show that basically we can, like using scaffolds with different pore sizes, we can have different vascularization patterns within the scaffolds, giving us the chance to precisely regenerate the tissue defect in the human system. However, the histology results that I just showed has been collected using conventional strategies based on, for example, the cryotome or sectioning, which is a labor-intensive process and also is time-consuming, right? So that's why a secondary part of the PhD work was trying to develop different imaging technologies to be able to allow us to characterize the engineered tissues and their qualities in a non-invasive and in a like continuous manner. And in particular, we, in collaboration with Dr. Li Hong Wang, who was in WashU and who is now in Caltech actually right now, we specifically focused on this photoacoustic imaging, which is a combination of light and ultrasound imaging, which gives us not only the penetration depths, but also the resolution that we need for characterizing tissues. And as such, we can now monitor these engineered tissues and their qualities in a non-invasive manner, continuous in the human body, ranging from high-resolution imaging of the single cells to cells on the scaffolds to scaffolds themselves, and how the scaffolds are interacting with the tissues in the human body. And again, taking the scaffolds with different pore sizes example, we can, instead of having the histology slide that I showed in the before, we can also use this photoacoustic imaging to non-invasively monitor how the vascularization is going on in the human system, actually in the animal, in this case, for scaffolds with different pore sizes that we implanted, and we did see a differential response of the vascularization in scaffolds with smaller pore sizes and larger pore sizes. All right, so when I came to Boston, I learned another challenge of the facing the whole healthcare field, so which is the drug development. So with all the pharma companies around Boston, I learned that the drug development process is highly costly and taking extremely long time, and without much of the high efficiency. So the primary reason for that is conventional models that people use for developing the drug molecules are either based on planar static cell cultures or animal models, and both of which don't really recapitulate the human system, right? Because as we know, the human systems are dynamic, three-dimensional, and these cannot be recapitulated by the 2D cell cultures. And animals, they're physiologically relevant, but they're having genetic differences, so many of the drugs that are tested efficient or safe in animals, they don't really translate into human body. So this is why I then used my tissue engineering background that I accumulated in the PhD studies to basically generate these now in vitro models of human tissues on these little microfluidic chip devices for better drug development and also personalized medicine when I came to Boston. And these are essentially miniaturized versions of the human tissues and organs that we can make on the little devices which allow us to reproduce the dynamic environment of the human system. And most importantly, we can connect this different organ on a chip devices together in a way that the different organs connect in the human system. So we can also start to study these, their interactions outside human body for more accurate drug testing and development. And eventually, I think as Roxanne also mentioned, we can potentially combine with, for example, like stem cells, so we can eventually start to also do personalized medicine as well using these devices. So again, as I mentioned, one of the most important components is the bioreactor systems, which are those microfluidic units that are hosting the organoids that we generate. And this is the one of the simplest form of bioreactor, which has only a simple chamber where we can put the microtissues in for dynamic flow culture. And we can make variations as well. For example, we can add a layer in the middle and put endothelial cells on top. So now we can form a very nice layer of the endothelium on the membrane, so we can now study also the, for example, transport of the drugs through this endothelial barrier and how they interact with the surrounding tissues. And as we know, the human systems are dynamic, right? For example, in the vessel system, they're not really static with the heart beat, right? So the vessels are constantly dilating and constricting. So we can also build these mechanical cues onto this little microfluidic devices, so we can model the contractions of the vessel wall and study their effects on the cells or vascular cells seated on top. And we can also form unconventional microfluidic devices. For example, the vessels in the human body are circularized, so we can also make these circular devices which are then endothelialized with these vascular cells, so we can use them to connect different organoids to really mimic the function of the vessels connecting different organs in the human system. And one of the recent developments in the lab is, again, so the previous ones are based on the elastomer materials, which are having issues when testing drug molecules because they tend to absorb or absorb these small molecules, especially those that are hydrophobic. So we have been devoting our efforts on generating also thermoplastic materials for microfluidic chip fabrication, so we can avoid those kind of issues, and we were able to generate all those different types of microfluidic units for controlling purposes and build them into the bioreactors for that purpose. All right. So now we can also start to multiply the complexity of the microfluidic devices, and everything can is automatically controlled using our controllers. So I guess the last part I'm going to really briefly talk about is the biofabrication. So now you have the bioreactors. The next problem is how do you actually generate three-dimensional tissue that are functional within these microfluidic devices for drug testing, right? So as we know, the human system are systems are complex, right? So here shows some exemplary organs, which are usually comprised of little tissue building units at micro scale, which are again very complex, right? So the challenges here are how do we reproduce the complexity of human tissue microarchitecture, and how do we mimic the interactions between the different cell types. So in this way, we actually used bioprinting to generate our microscale tissue models in the chips. So one strategy that we did earlier was the extrusion, multi-material extrusion bioprinting, which we combined multiple bio-inks into a single nozzle. And by controlling how the nozzle moves around and bio-ink deposition, we can start to generate like human tissue-like or organ-like structures at a miniaturized scale using this bioprinting strategy. And recently, we have also extended this multi-material printing into another strategy called stereolithographic bioprinting, which is layer-by-layer printing system, and we incorporate the microfluidic device to allow the system to be able to also produce multiple materials that are mimicking our microtissues directly on the chips. And we have been focusing on vascular bioprinting as well, because vessels are essentially one of the most important components of all tissue types. So with sacrificial bioprinting, we can make these little channels, which we can then endothelialize to model the human vessel system. And we can then start to model, for example, the vascular disorders. We can put whole human blood into the channels and let them clot in there, right? So now we can form thrombos in the channels, modeling the human thrombos in the human vessels, right? So if we do histology, we can see that these models are, the model that we have engineered was very similar to the real human thrombos, giving us the capacity to model the, like to study the pathology and also developing the treatments. We can also start to model microvasculature on a scale of a few tens of micrometers using other sacrificial bioprinting strategies. And not only we have vascular structures that are hollow, we have other structures that are hollow as well in the human body. For example, the mammary ducts, right? So in this case, we actually use the sacrificially printed hollow channels to model breast cancer and how the cancer cells were proliferating in the ducts. And when they became confident, how they started to migrate into surrounding matrix, modeling this, reproducing this ductal carcinoma in situ to invasive ductal carcinoma process. And we can also direct print hollow fibers as well using a coaxial multi-layered nozzle, allowing us to direct print multi-layered vessel bed that is perfusible. And we can also complex this with multi-material by printing for producing the transitional structures that we have in the human system, because the vessels, we know that they're not really uniform, right? So a lot of vessels are coming from multi-layer to single layer and going back to the multi-layer. So we can also do this perfectly. We can also print, for example, by electronic devices using bioprinting that are not only conductive but also are biocompatible. So we can now start to model, for example, bioelectrically conductive devices. Okay, so I think we have also basically been able to develop all the sensors for monitoring tissue, like organ noise on the chips, as I showed in the beginning. With the tissue monitoring. So this allows us to basically look at how the organ nodes are behaving or interacting with drug molecules in the system. All right, so I think with that slide, I'm going to thank all the funding agency and collaborators across the world, and also the great lab members across several generations, and of course my mentors, PhD advisor, Professor Yulan Shen, and postdoctoral advisor, Professor Ali Demhusseini, and all the collaborators. Thank you very much.